everyone, welcome back to another episode of Behind the Curtain, where we get to explore the stories, passions, and insights about the best performances and artists around the world. So I have a question for you tonight. What does Bridgerton, Green Book, and this summer's latest release of Respect all have in common? Well, I'll tell you. It is Kris Bowers. Kris is the composer of these films and series, along with many more, and he is our special guest tonight. We're going to sit down with Kris and hear more about what inspires him to create these pieces. What does it look like to score for a film or a television series? And hear more about his upcoming concert that's going to take place at SFJAZZ for their opening night on September 23rd. So without further ado, let's welcome him on. Hey, Kris, it's good to see you.
Hey, Gary, good to see you too.
Yeah, awesome. It's great to meet you. I've been following your career for a while and I'm a big fan of your music. So I'm excited to learn a little bit more about what you're working on and some of the projects that you have coming up up your way.
Appreciate it. Yeah, thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Okay, let's start from the beginning, because I know you get a lot of questions around like, where does this start? And I was reading some, you know, some great context about you, that your parents wanted you to be a pianist from day one, basically before you were even born. You played all this music, and you started playing piano at 4 years old, which is awesome. I actually started at four too. I'm curious, you know, like that is something that, you know, parents seem to do, like, hey, I want you to do this, that. But when, my question is, when did you decide that the piano was for you? And then also kind of what got you started into not just playing, but composing your own music?
Yeah, well, I think the that shift for me definitely happened when I started to learn how to improvise and start composing, just because I think it then immediately became a vehicle for me to express emotion. I think when I was first starting, piano was nice to be good at something, or to have something that, you know, it was almost like a party trick. You know, my parents would be like, oh, go play something on piano, essentially. And that was fine, but I didn't really love practicing or love playing until I started to discover, I had a jazz teacher when I was maybe about 10 or so, 9 or 10. And that was my first time, you know, getting a handful of little licks that he taught me that I could kind of play and improvise with and things like that. And around that same time, I had been taking theory lessons for a little while. And so between theory and these new jazz lessons, my ear was starting to get much better. And so then I was also able to start picking out songs from the radio and start playing those things. And, you know, in middle school, being a musician is not the coolest thing at all. And so I think that, you know, being able to play songs from the radio made me like a little bit cooler. And by the time I went to high school, my freshman year, I was 12 going into high school. And so I by that time was like, I had a small moment where I wanted to maybe be a cartoonist, but at that point, piano was already something that I really loved and felt like it was my thing. But that first freshman year in high school, I just felt so deep in love with it. And I was like, I'm not doing anything else, and this is going to be my career. And really kind of dove in at that point.
I love that. And so it's almost like cartooning, you're creating a character and a storyline. You found kind of the same passions within music, because music is all about embodying characters and storylines, right?
Yeah, exactly. I think that's the thing that was really interesting, was how these art forms, like you're just saying, can help tell some sort of narrative. And with improvisation, I think that's the way that I always looked at it. Even if I'm performing in the moment, it was always like, okay, well, how do I feel? Or how does this moment feel? Or what is this song saying? How do I want to improvise to try to evoke some sort of specific feeling in this moment, and kind of continue to follow the motifs that are developing in real time. And I think that's what made improv so exciting for me. But definitely once I discovered film scoring as a career space when I was about 12 as well, I was like, that's definitely what I want to do at some point, just because of that aspect of being able to help tell a story through music alone.
When you're not composing and you're sitting at the piano, what are some of the composers you like to play, or what kind of music do you find yourself gravitating towards?
I'm always playing standards, just like old jazz standards, which are usually, you know, American songbook songs, but especially ballads. I just really love playing like Hoagie Carmichael ballads, or even like Gershwin ballads, or you know, Strayhorn and different things like that. Then for anything else, it's usually like, if it's not a standard or a ballad, it's also Monk. I play a lot of Thelonious Monk in my free time, and then just different film scores. I might like play through different melodies that I really love from different scores, like Michel Legrand or John Williams, of course, or Bernard Herrmann scores. But yeah, just kind of like certain melodies that really stick with me, I like playing as well. And also a lot of like more contemporary music as well. Like my band, whenever we played shows, we would always do standard, like covers of newer material that to me felt like it's, you know, the standards of the day. I had a mentor once that mentioned how the thing about jazz standards is that they were pop songs of the time. So like when you heard somebody playing, some sort of standard from a Broadway musical, you also probably could have seen that musical that same night. You know, he used to say something like, you could go see a Broadway show in Midtown and then go downtown and see the jazz musicians playing that same song. And that's why you had so many people that could connect to these pieces, because if they've heard these songs being sung in other contexts, and now they hear this jazz musician making it a bit more abstract or stretching it a little bit, they have some sort of thing to hold on to. And so I kind of felt like, and I think a lot of jazz musicians in my generation feel like, yeah, it's interesting to then take songs that are like by Radiohead or Death Cab for Cutie, or, you know, Ray LaMontagne, or like Sufjan Stevens, or these kinds of musicians as well, and cover some of that. And I've always found that really exciting too.
Yeah, and not only do you guys love it, like audiences love it. I think it's so interesting to see a different version of a song, right? Like, what's your spin to it? I mean, you can take one song, and I was talking to a friend about this, like, here's three different versions of one song. And they're like, oh my gosh, that's so cool. I'm like, you really can do, composing can be also like arranging a piece of something that you love and just putting kind of your spin on it, which is, I think it's so much fun to watch and listen to. Sure. Okay, so you've worked on so many amazing films and television series. I want to talk about your process about this. When music comes, okay, so when does the music come to the picture, right? Do you start once the filming is completed, after you've read a script, or maybe do you start even before a script has been written? I'm always curious about that for film.
Yeah, it really depends. It's tends to be mostly toward the end of the process. There are definitely a handful of projects where the director or filmmakers find it really important to get into the music conversation as early as possible. And so with that, usually they already have a script, and I will read the script and start to formulate different themes, or just, you know, looking at how we could find a palette, and like just what the sound of the film or the show is going to be based on the script alone. I haven't really been involved before a script, which I think would be really interesting, but I feel like usually it's when the script is already done. But the most common thing is when we have maybe like a handful of months before the picture is completely finished. It's like they've just finished filming, they're getting into the edit, and now they wanted to start talking about music, since that's kind of one of the first parts of the process. Depending on where we go or how early I'm involved kind of dictates how I approach it.
Mm-hmm. That's so interesting, because, you know, I went to this great concert back in the day at the San Francisco Symphony, and it was with John Williams conducting and Steven Spielberg was narrating it.
Oh, wow.
It was amazing, like one of the best concerts of my life. And he basically played, he's like, I want you to hear Indiana Jones, just the film. So we watched this clip, and he's like, now I want to put the music to the film. And so then the symphony played, and it was like two different movies. I mean, you had this anticipation. So I I think that's really fascinating that the music comes after, because even as a character, an actor, an actress, I feel like I would almost want to hear the music in the background a little bit to just like get into the mood a little bit, right? And so it's
clear. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, and it can totally, like you just said, change the way that the film feels or looks even sometimes. Yeah.
Okay, here's one more question about this. So, you know, one of the scores that you wrote was for Bridgerton, and it's such a fun series, and they're all dancing, right? Okay, so what are they dancing to if they haven't heard your music?
Most of the time in those dance sequences, they're actually dancing to music. It's like, funny enough, it was actually a bunch of pop songs that they were dancing to. And then we would find the tempo of those pop songs and then write something at that tempo so that it still felt like they were dancing to the music, but it was just a different piece.
I was always wondering, like, what are they listening to? Are they listening to like a click track or what is it? So you actually have to take the beat of what they were dancing to and kind of like, all right, here is my structure of the song. Yep. Just to go, wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So here's another question about Bridgerton, since, you know, I'm a big fan of period pieces. I love all things period pieces, like Downton Abbey, Bridgerton, you name it. So for this, you know, this is a very unique time period. It's 1800s. So what did you listen to, or what did you read, or what did you watch, just to get into like, okay, what did this sound like? You mentioned a palette. How did you find the palette for Bridgerton?
Yeah, well, the palette for that was really interesting, because one of the first things they told me in that process when they only had the scripts and sent me the first few of them was that they wanted it to sound very unexpected for the time, essentially, and wanting it to feel, you know, they kept saying this is not your mother or your grandmother's Regency period piece. They wanted it to feel like it was a bit different in the energy that it felt. And so there were a few things that kind of helped find the sound and the palette for it. One was early on, we tried a couple of different things that just didn't work. Like, I tried based on that prompt to write music that felt really period appropriate, but then chop it up and make samples out of it. So then I was like making almost like pop tracks or hip hop tracks out of these classical samples. Then that didn't really feel right. And then I tried another way that was really, really time specific or period specific, where I was writing the style of like mostly Beethoven, as far as, you know, being really centered and anchored in that early 19th century writing. And that felt like it was too predictable and too stuffy. And the two things that really helped unlock the sound, one, I needed to come up with the theme for Daphne and Simon on piano before they were shooting, because they were playing, the actress Phoebe was playing the piano for those sequences. It was an episode where she was having this recurring dream where she would hear this melody and she was trying to find the melody on piano. And so I had to write that piece before they shot that. And Kris Van Dusen, the showrunner, gave me a couple of Ravel piano pieces that he really loved that helped inspire that. But it also really opened my mind up to a totally different era and style of classical writing, because that's, you know, more 20th century writing, and it has this like impressionistic sound and it's much more romantic, and it just made complete sense to me. And I was so focused on either being really time specific or really modern and not really looking at what else we could do kind of in between that. And so that was really something that helped me think about how I could approach it differently harmonically or orchestrationally based on that inspiration. And then the other thing that was really helpful were these covers that were selected, because I remember hearing the first cover in the first episode when we hear Thank You Next. And that immediately made me think about how even I immediately could empathize with these characters on a different level hearing this song and thinking about what that song means to, you know, especially the women in my life that love that song and talk about that song, and then think about the women in this show and how they're feeling in this whole scenario and in this courting, you know, context. And so I feel like that idea also led me to look at a lot of pop songs to think about how I could borrow some of the production elements and make them orchestration approaches. So like, you know, if how the bass and guitar part might lock up might inspire the way that like the cello and basses lock in with the viola part or something like that. And, you know, kind of looking at things rhythmically from that perspective as well. So I feel like those two things really helped find a specific sound for the show.
I love that. I actually, when I was watching it, one of the covers, I was like, is this? Wait a minute. And I had to listen in closely and I was like, oh, I see you. Okay, so that's what I want to ask about next is what are the differences for writing from a TV series to a film? Like, for instance, did you write more songs for Bridgerton because it's a longer series versus your newest release, Respect, which is a film? Is there more music, more time committed to composing for those?
Yeah, definitely way more music. You know, I think that in film, it can definitely range, you know, for something like Respect, ironically, is maybe like 10 minutes of score. It's very, very little score in that film. Then there's something like King Richard that's coming out, which is like 45 minutes of music, and Space Jam had like 80 minutes of music. But the last episode of Bridgerton alone had almost a little over an hour of music.
And oh, wow.
So each of these episodes was ranging anywhere from, on the low side, maybe 20 minutes of music, and on the high side, about an hour. So I'd say in total, it's probably, you know, a couple hundred minutes of music, let's say. And the other thing that's different is just being able to see the arc of a character's story over time. And, you know, with TV, I actually like to, one, we're usually only seeing the episodes as they're prepared. And so even if I have the scripts, you know, certain aspects might change, or the way it feels when you're seeing it definitely affects the way that you're feeling. And so there are times where I'm working on episode 2 and I have no idea what's really coming in episode 7 or 8. And you then have to focus way more on just what's happening in this specific episode and how do you develop thematic material throughout just this episode. But I think that's also what's really helpful about a show like Bridgerton, where you have really strong thematic material that you can, like you were saying, connect that with these characters throughout the show. And so, you know, I'm just kind of following the lead. You're a bit more, as a composer, I feel like you're having to trust the vision of the director and the producers so much more with the TV show, because there's so many times where a director will say like, okay, well, this moment you should really approach this way, because in the next episode, we're actually going to see this happen. So that's really why we want to set it up like this emotionally. And, you know, with a film, I'm able to really take a step back and see the whole picture in one go. And it's easier to kind of go back and forth where, you know, I might start with the film in random parts of the film, or not random, but parts that connect directly to me emotionally, and that might not be the very beginning or the very end. And it might be like, you know, a scene, you know, 2/3 of the way through the film is the moment that really spoke to me, but then that thematic material will help me go back to, you know, the first third and find ways to put that person or that character or that thematic material earlier. And with a show, that's not as possible. I mean, there have been shows I've worked on where, you know, the first couple of episodes, we were finding the sound. And so by the third episode, it kind of feels and sounds a little different than maybe it did even on episode 1, because we kind of found that. And with Bridgerton, we were really lucky because we worked on a few episodes at a time before we locked anything in. And so, you know, we actually worked on a little bit on episodes 1, 2, and 3 before finishing episode 1. And so that really allowed me to find a sound for the show by episode 3, because I really understood the world and the characters and what was happening. So that way, when we went back to episode 1, we already had something kind of locked in. And so it really depends. But I think the overall difference is, again, having that ability to see the full scope of a story with a film, and really only getting these slices with a TV show, and also, you know, having to be a little bit more focused on these smaller moments when it comes to thematic development.
That's crazy. I mean, like, I just, like, listening here, I'm like, how did you even do either one? Like, this.
small bites.
Dang, that's amazing. Okay, one thing within this, though, is time, right? Like, you're mentioning that sometimes you get the film, and then you're like, all right, I got this time to, like, do this arch and all this great stuff. And then for for television, is it short amount of time? Like, tell me maybe some comparisons of like, oh, for this movie, I had this much time, or for a show, I had only this much.
Yeah, so for, you know, for a film like Space Jam, I had almost 2 years where we were working on music. And so it was awesome. Really small moments where I'm like, every week we had about a year out, we had meetings on a weekly basis. And that was, you know, me sharing like 5 minutes of music every week, essentially. And so it was very small bites, but over a long period of time. With a movie like King Richard, I had like 3 months to finish the score. And then with shows, really what happens is that I come on early enough where we maybe have, I'd say on average about 2 months to start finding the sound of the show and start workshopping ideas and themes and things like that. For the most part, there are times where I'm on a show for even earlier. But for the most part, it's just like a couple of months before they're really ready to start recording things and locking it in. And then once the machine gets going, though, then it's about a week or two that we have per episode. So by the end of, even though for the first three episodes of Bridgerton that I was saying we were workshopping, I had probably a little bit more with that, maybe like 5 months or so to kind of find a sound and all that. By the time we finished episode three, for the rest of the season, I had maybe about 2 weeks to turn around the rest of the music.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Okay. So like the comparative that I can see in my mind, probably for viewers watching, is writing. Like we've all had to write a good essay, right? Or a good email, or a good deck, or whatever that might be for your business. Perfect. And sometimes you just have writer's block. Like I just am not in that creative zone. And so I'm curious, like, how have you kind of disciplined yourself to get into the zone quickly? Where do you go? Do you go into this room that you're in now? Is this kind of your spot, or where do you,
I'm usually in here when I'm starting stuff, especially because, like, you know, this is our piano room, and I'm usually at the piano when I'm starting things, and it just feels a little bit more immediate than working on, even on a keyboard on the computer. It just feels like a little too separate, you know? And I think the thing that really gets me going is studying or listening to something else, because usually there's something that I find that is going to inspire me or make me think of how I could do something in a slightly different way or something like that. And I'm always fascinated by finding what other composers have studied or looked at for references, and or even just outside of that. Like there's, I don't know if you've ever seen that thing it's called Everything's a Remix. It's like a video that, it talks about how everything that we see is inspired by something else. And so I think for me, usually it starts with listening to music or reading something that has to do with storytelling or psychology or something that can kind of get me into an emotional headspace where now I'm like excited about exploring something, and it feels a little less daunting when I'm taking it from a piece of like a seed that comes from something right. else than imagining that I need to like reinvent the wheel every time.
That's exactly what I was thinking. It's like, okay, so he's talking about reinventing the wheel. I always say that to some of my teammates, like, let's not reinvent the wheel, like let's see what's been done and let's like then elevate it, right? Or just take it to a different direction. So that's okay, that's awesome.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so my next thing is around respect, because I am just so excited to see this film. It's definitely what we're going to have it on our list for this weekend to come see to the theaters. Right. So I want to talk about some of your background, getting the chance to meet Aretha Franklin and work with her. So my question is, how did you get to meet her, and what was it like having known her and then working on a piece that was a really commemorative film about her life?
Yeah, it was one just pretty remarkable and special to have known her. And I met her first at the Thelonious Monk piano competition, and she was receiving essentially like a lifetime achievement award that weekend. And the way the competition works out is that the first day is the semifinals, and then the second day are the finals. And the semifinal concert is pretty informal, and you know, it's maybe like the 12 semifinalists that have made it to that point. And we each do like a 30-minute set. And so I did my 30 minutes, And I came off, and as I'm walking backstage, somebody was like, "Do you mind meeting someone in the front really quickly?" And I was like, "Yeah, sure, that's fine." And as we're walking to the front, they're like, "By the way, it's Aretha Franklin that you're about to meet." And I just remember being speechless and shocked, and feeling, you know, I have such a huge respect for her and her artistry that I think it was one of the first times that I felt that starstruck in front of someone. And she, you know, I met her and she told me that she was really blown away by my playing, that I was her favorite for the weekend, and she really hoped that I won. And I just asked my contact information. And so the rest of the weekend, she told other people that I was her favorite and all of that, but I kind of wasn't thinking anything of it. And then maybe a week after the competition, I just got a call from a number, and this woman started asking me questions about the competition and all these things. And halfway through, I realized it was Aretha herself that had called me. And it was in that conversation that she asked me if I had a plan for my career. She was like, "You know, you won this competition, and I heard that it comes with a record deal, and like, what are your plans to do for that? And, you know, do you have a manager?" And I didn't at the time. And so she recommended, she told me that your manager, your first manager, should be your biggest cheerleader. And so my publicist, this woman, Tracy Jordan, I think would make a great manager for you. And so she became my first manager. Tracy's the woman that found my first film score because of how much I talked about doing that. And then from that point on, Aretha just became a person that I could go to for that type of career advice, where I could kind of ask her what I should do about this kind of situation, or, you know, thinking about that kind of thing. She also was always so fascinated by the piano and getting better at the piano. And so she would always ask me, like, you know, what exercises are you doing right now? Or like, what have you been practicing? Or, you know, talking about what she's been practicing and what she found has been helping her with piano, which I always thought was fascinating, given that she's, you know, Aretha Franklin, talking about how she could be better at playing piano. And then I played for like Christmas parties and birthday parties and her induction to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and all these other things. And so, yeah, it just became such a special relationship. And then to work on the film, I feel like was definitely surreal in moments, and also just felt like, and very surreal for it to have come in this way. And you know, it felt like, you know, they could have, it just so happened that Liesl, the director, Liesl Tommy, liked me as a composer, separate from my relationship with Aretha. So it wasn't even like it came to me just because of that. It was just more so because of them following my track record as a composer, which felt really special that, you know, the universe kind of brought that. And mostly just seeing how much she worked through and moved through throughout her life, and what she was dealing with and struggling with, I think was something that, you know, I wish I'd known when she was alive, but also, or at least known the magnitude of it, but also just gave me so much more respect for the type of artist she was and the music that she was putting out while she at the same time was dealing with any of the hardships she was dealing with.
Mm-hmm. That's amazing. What a great story. I mean, it's all about helping other people, right? When you see others, it's like, man, Kris, who are you going to reach your hand out to next, right? Like continuing the love and the baton of like, hey, I like what you're doing. I'm your cheerleader. How can I help you? It's all really about a community of people seeing each other and saying, hey, I'm behind you. What do you need? And that's a really, really cool thing to remember. Just a good reminder for all of us is like, okay, how can I help the next generation to achieve their dreams, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, 100%.
I love that. Well, what a cool friendship you guys had. And I can't wait to see the film and hear the music that you composed for that. That's so special. Just kind of almost a full circle moment, I'm sure, for you.
Yeah, totally, totally. Yeah, Jennifer Hudson's incredible in it. So, yeah.
That's awesome. Now, okay, you're on tour. You're doing a lot of different concerts. You know, I'm sure you're still composing for some films coming up as well. But I'm excited for you to be at SFJAZZ for their opening night on Thursday, September 23rd. I want to know, what can we expect? What are you going to be performing? What kind of insight can you give us about this concert?
Yeah, so I'm pretty much just going to be playing mostly music from projects that I've been working on, some of my favorite scores that I've worked on, and then also some music that's kind of inspired my compositional process. You know, I think that what's been interesting about getting back to playing live shows, since I haven't really been playing for a while, I've mostly just been scoring. When I got the opportunity to start doing live shows again, the first thing that came to mind was to just kind of be able to take these pieces that I've written for these, you know, small moments that kind of come and go in the context of a film, and really be able to sit in them a little bit longer. You know, there's so many times where I write a cue that you spend so much time thinking about the emotion of, and what it's saying and what it's supposed to feel like and mean in this moment. And it takes like a minute and a half for us to hear it in the context of this film. And then we kind of miss the, or, you know, don't really think about it after that. It's really about how that works in the full storytelling. But I think for me as a performing artist, it's nice to then take some of these pieces and then improvise around them, or, you know, kind of talk about my process, which does include improvisation, where I might think about what is this moment supposed to feel like, and how do I improvise around a sound until I find a theme or find something that kind of speaks to that moment. And then that'll all be, not all, but most of it will be accompanied by a series of these short films that are really like these vignettes of everyday people that represent the themes that these films spoke to. Because for me, a lot of my process was, again, thinking about how these moments in a film feel outside of the context of that film. And so for something like Respect, it's really about Aretha's difficulty with the trauma that she dealt with a lot of her life. And a lot of the score is looking at her in these really vulnerable, intimate moments where she's reliving these past experiences and traumas as a kid. And so for me, I think writing for that, I felt like I needed to think about what that feels like for myself, or what that feels like in general, to think about, you know, things that have happened to us when we were younger that we're still dealing with, or still carrying, or still trying to find a way to work through, and trying to imagine what she dealt with, which I can't really imagine, but doing my best to kind of imagine that, and taking it out of the context of the film itself, I think usually helps me find some sort of direct emotional connection to it. My wife's actually helping to produce these and directed all these vignettes. And basically we're looking at four of the projects, King Richard, which is the Will Smith film about Venus and Serena Williams' dad, Bridgerton, Green Book, and When They See Us. And with each of those, we have these short vignettes of everyday people that embody what helped inspire the themes for me. So like for When They See Us, it's mothers and their sons and that relationship, and what happens to that relationship as the mothers have to grapple with how the world treats their son when they look a certain way. Or Green Book, it's about musicians from underrepresented backgrounds that are dealing with the feeling of entering these institutions that maybe feel like they didn't represent them, or feel like they maybe don't belong in those spaces, and how do they do that and still find a way to connect to their music. And then for Bridgerton, it's about couples and love and the ups and downs of that, and choosing to love someone on a daily basis, even when you have those difficult moments. And so we just found a handful of people that, you know, for Bridgerton, it's real couples, like friends of ours that we just, you know, filmed in these really beautiful ways and had them talk about, there's no dialogue, but, you know, to get them in that headspace, we talk about, you know, different things that they might have felt in these ups and downs. And for King Richard, it's fathers and their daughters. And for Green Book, it'll be a handful of musicians from underrepresented backgrounds. And then we also have Yersa Daly Ward, who's an incredible poet that has written some poetry based on these themes. And we have some of the people from those projects speaking those as voiceovers, like Mahershala speaking the stuff from Green Book, or Ava DuVernay speaking the poems for When They See Us. So it's kind of like this multimedia, somewhat immersive kind of project. Yeah.
Oh my gosh, you guys. Okay, I've got my tickets. I hope you do. I love the SFJAZZ. I was looking at it, I was like, okay, this looks so cool, but like, what is it? Like, you don't really know kind of what, we know it's you, Kris, which is awesome in itself, but then like, what were you going to play? So like, okay, so we got the insider. So I'm in. I hope everyone else is in. Amazing. I love that your wife is involved in the project and you guys are collaborating together, which sounds like a really fun collaboration.
Yeah.
So cool. Okay, I have one more question for you. You know, you've been such an inspiration to follow, personally, just to see another young professional out there going after their dreams and seeing your career unfold into these amazing achievements and creations that you've made. And I've also really loved hearing your family's story through your grandfather that was featured in the Academy Award nominated short story that was released in 2020. So with all of this, Kris, your accomplishments and your family's lineage that really means a lot to you, I have kind of a deep question just to dig in, because I think people often ask themselves something similar. For you, what is the peak of your mountain, right? So what is the ultimate dream that you hope to achieve as a modern day composer and musician, since you have all of this amazing background? What's your your big moment that you're looking for?
Yeah, I think just hoping to leave some sort of mark that can directly and indirectly help that next generation. You know, I think that for me, I feel like when I look at the people that have inspired me directly and indirectly, you know, it's composers that have not just, you know, one or two films that they've worked on that were really impactful, but just kind of have a number of things that they did for years and years and years that really compounded to be this legacy that you can really look up to and really feel inspired by. And I think that just speaks to the daily work that kind of goes into trying to make the best art you can on a regular basis. But then also, I think for me personally, there's so many people that directly had a hand in my just even finding music or I think about my parents very frequently with how we didn't come from an area where we had easy access to great education in general, but also just great music education. And they fought tooth and nail to find every possible space for me to be in where I could feel like I was on an even playing field with everybody else when it came to general education, but also especially with music. And I feel like so lucky that stuff was done for me in some sort of way where, you know, I found or my parents found these teachers or these institutions that then changed the way that I looked at myself or the world or all these things. And I feel like that's something that, you know, especially for a kid, for a young Black boy like me, I think that having that constant reaffirmation or constant push to try something or to, you know, try to be better at this craft, and then to see how that affected my life compared to anybody else that might come from the same space that I came from, feels like something that I would want to find a way to put back into the system as well, just because I feel like there's so many people that I look at, or so many educational things that I've done where you look at how few boys and girls of color are in those spaces, or, you know, even in this industry, seeing how few men and women of color are in these spaces, or just the diversity in general, how it's lacking. And I think that a lot of that starts with education. And so, you know, kind of thinking about how I could have some sort of impact on that, because I feel like, you know, it's one thing to be an inspiration indirectly just by being what you are and by doing those things. But I feel like, again, for me, I wouldn't be who I was without the mentors I had, people that I felt like I could call or get advice from, or even just look at as inspiration. Feels, yeah, really important. So I think kind of those two things would be the things that feel like would be something I could feel really happy that I achieved before the end of all this.
That's awesome. When you have, it sounds like there's this greater thing, you know, that you represent and you're, you know, that you're wanting to put in front of the next person, the next generation, that you're like, hey, I'm helping pave the way in some regard, but I also hope that my music touches you and education. I love that as well. I can definitely relate to that. I think one of mine, just to throw in here too, is when I went to college, I thought, God, I don't know if I'm going to do this, you know, and I remember a distinct moment. My mom said, go to college complete all these things for the women that didn't have the opportunity. And that just resonated with me every day. Today, even as being a CEO of my own company, I do this for the women that didn't have the opportunity, so that people can see women in, you know, great leadership roles or people going after their dreams, right? And so that's just exciting. I think we all kind of live for like, all right, let's set the next group up for success and let me do my part in helping with that, right? And so I think that's a really amazing thing. The family that shapes us, right? The people around us shape us and we shape others as well, which is a really powerful, powerful position.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, Kris, so maybe one more bonus question for you. Because I know I said one last one, but I'm curious, you know, what's next? What are you working on? What's on the piano over there that you're composing? Tell us.
Yeah. Most immediately, I'm finishing up this French horn concerto that is going to be premiered with the LA Phil in November. And it's also going to include some of this material that we're showing at the SFJAZZ with these films and all that kind of stuff. We're going to do those pieces with the full orchestra. So it'll be this whole evening that I'm curating for the LA Phil in November. And then I'm really excited for King Richard, which I've finished, but King Richard comes out in November as well. And then in a couple of months, I'll really just be diving into Bridgerton season 2 and a couple of other projects, like a Netflix film and a couple of Marvel projects. So yeah.
Gosh. Okay. So just a few, like, you know, things. Yeah. That is amazing. Okay. So when are you going to write an oboe concerto, Kris? You know, being an oboe.
That's next. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's been so fascinating to like learn more about these instruments, you know, it's like so different writing for a soloist than a section. And so, yeah, that'd be really fun to kind of dive into the oboe.
Man, one of my favorite oboe concerto composers is Saint-Saëns. So if you ever and you're like, okay, I gotta write this thing for the oboe, go to Saint-Saëns, because he has the most lyrical, beautiful, it's really the composer that I found a voice. So I was like, yes, this is the music that was basically written for me when I played it. And so that's one of my, tips.
Yeah, I love him as a composer. I definitely would check that out. That's awesome.
So awesome. Kris, thank you so much for joining me today. Yeah, of course. To get to know you and hear kind of the things that you're working on and also hear all about the inspiration that inspires you, because I think that's something that we can reflect on ourselves as we are going after our own dreams, whatever that might be, in the music world or in the business world, you name it. So you guys, if you want to follow Kris and all of his adventures, check him out on Instagram, Kris Bowers Music, and then check him out on Spotify. That's what I have on my repeat right now, Kris. I'm listening to all your music. And I've just been loving it. I love film scores and even just some of your other things that you've been doing. It's really exciting to hear. So thank you, Kris, for joining us. It's been fun.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thanks for the questions, Carrie.
And to find out more about Kris and his upcoming performance at SFJAZZ for their opening night concert on September 23rd, head over to their website at sfjazz.org. And surprise, we are going to be launching a brand new platform on Red Curtain Addict. I am so excited to share it with you. So to be the first to see it and interact with it, head over to redcurtainaddict.com/newsletter to be a part of our community. It's been so much fun to spend this evening with you. Thank you so much for joining in, and I look forward to seeing you next time.